Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we worship and we praise you. We honor your name. We glorify you, for you are God. There is none like you in heaven and on earth and under the waters. We want to praise you and to glorify you for what you've done in our lives, and even for giving us a moment to share the word of the Lord and to be taught by the Holy Spirit. What we pray, my Father and my God, is that we shall align with what the Spirit is saying, and we shall learn from you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray and we believe. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. I'd like to welcome all of you from all over you listening to us from, and even those who are listening to us through the public address. I'd like to continue the topic we've had for some time now, the topic about prayer. And for like a month or so, we've been taught what prayer is, and we saw from the book of Matthew chapter 6 that the disciples came to Jesus and they told him, teach us to pray. And it's good to understand that as much as prayer is more spiritual than it is physical, people can be taught to pray. This is the mistake we have in the body of Christ, because people do not know that prayer can be taught. People do not know that they can learn to pray. And so that is the business we've been doing for the last a month or so, teaching. The Holy Spirit is teaching us how to pray. And we saw from the book of Matthew chapter 6, from verse 5, that Jesus started to take them through sessions of what we call a manner or pattern that you need to follow as much as or as long as you are going to pray. And today I want to teach for a few minutes about different types of prayer. Because when we say prayer, it's a broad topic, and we can never teach prayer in its entirety unless you learn to pray by yourself. What we do is that we can give you nuggets and patterns here and there to guide you when you pray. And so I'd like to teach us, or I'd like the Holy Spirit through me to teach us on different types of prayer, because it is good to know. When Jesus said, when you pray, pray like this or pray after this manner, you need to know that there is a when. Of course, he said that pray without ceasing, or he speak a parable that men ought always to pray. And so it's good to understand what Jesus meant when he said, men ought always to pray and not to faint. How comes a man can pray every time and every hour and every minute? Is it practical? And so I'd like to take us through just one, what I would call a type of prayer. We know there's the prayer of faith. We know there are many types of prayers, but today I want to talk about our thanksgiving prayer. The reason as to why I want to talk about this is because prayer has been personalized to be the only channel, or a channel to bring our petitions to God, a channel to tell God what we want, a channel to tell God what we lack, a channel to tell God what we need. But we do not know that we can use prayer as part of giving thanks to God. We can use prayer as part of our gratification, of our telling God thank you, not because of what you've done, but because of what you are. Because many times we want to pray, all what is in our mind is what has God given me to thank him. And if we were to look at everything that God has given you, even the moment you are thinking about that, it's already a good reason to thank God that your mind is functioning like that. And so, when we talk about prayer, let us not take prayer as the only channel, or let us not take prayer as in its entirety the only channel to ask God for what we need. And we saw last week that the Bible says, your Father knows what you need even before you tell him. If you read in the book of Ephesians 1 chapter 3, he says that he has given us all things in Christ Jesus, all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. And so God knows what you need even before you tell him. Now the good thing you need to understand is that you can use prayer as a channel to provoke what God has already given you in the spirit for it to manifest. What is one of those things? One of those things is through thanksgiving. The moment you come to God and tell him, Lord, thank you because you've healed me, you are provoking that dimension in God that gives healing to take expression in your life. Instead of telling God, am I going to die because of this sickness? Have mercy on me, or all those things. What you can do is that go to God and tell him, Father, thank you because I'm healed in Christ Jesus. What you are doing is that you are invoking what God did in the spirit to manifest in the flesh. The Bible says, I'd like us to read from the book of Philippians. The book of Philippians chapter 4. And I want us to know a few things about the prayer of thanksgiving. Because it is not a prayer that many Christians pray, because it does not look as good as we would ought to have to be. And so many people, even when they pray the prayer of thanksgiving, they don't know the things that govern this type of prayer. Because we see that every time you pray, there is a conscience you need to have that precedes your uttering. He says, to whom that is able to do abundantly above what we say or what we ask or think. So as much as you are saying is part of prayer, even your thinking is part of prayer. I've seen many times God answer me prayers that I did not necessarily say, prayers that I only thought about. And so many people, when you go to pray, you are telling God thank you. On the other hand, your mind is complaining to God. And so it is good to understand that every time you are praying, you must have a conscience. Because for example, when you pray in tongues, people pray in tongues, but they think it's all that or whatever. But there is a way you can channel your prayer or your praying in tongues to make the intercession. There is a way you can channel your praying in tongues to maybe thanksgiving. There is a way you can channel your praying in tongues to gaining spiritual stature. And so prayer in most cases, and I think in all cases, starts with conscience. Prayer starts in your mind, not after you say it. That is why he says, you don't have because you don't ask. But what happens when you ask? When you ask amiss. Why do you ask amiss? Because you ask to fulfill your evil desires. So what your tongue is saying is not what your mind is saying. And so it is good to know that when it comes to prayer of thanksgiving or any type of prayer, your conscience must precede what you are saying. Otherwise, what you are saying, because God is spirit. And so the easiest, what God will see first or what God will hear first, it is not necessarily what you say, but what you feel, what is in your heart. Because he says, I, God, searches on the intent of man, the intention of man. So before you say it, he has already heard it from your mind or from your heart. Because the Israelites did not complain to God by their talking. They complained from their hearts. They complained from their hearts. So even before they said it, God had already condemned them. So these are some of the things you need to understand when you engage in the prayer of thanksgiving. And let me tell you the truth, no matter the prayer you engage in, one of the most powerful prayers is the prayer of thanksgiving. I wish we can take more time in prayer giving thanks to God, other than necessarily telling God, I need this and that. Because he says in the book of 1 Peter that he has given unto us all things that pertaineth to life and to godliness. God is not a liar. When he says he has given you all those things, the first thing you need to ask yourself is, how will these things manifest? This is the question I had for many years, asking myself, if God has given me all these things, where then do I need to pray? Where then do I need to tell him what I need? Where then do I need to keep praying the same thing to God who has given me that thing? And I came to realize that you can use prayer as a channel to invoke what God has done in the spirit to manifest. And one of those ways is to do prayer of thanksgiving. I gave a story last time that there was a man of God, a very notable man of God, a father of faith to many, that called for a minister's conference. And so pastors came from all over the world to attend this conference, and they had about 2 hours of prayer. So they had put aside about 2 hours of prayer. And so everyone was praying. Everyone was saying, God give me this. God increase my numbers. God give me a car. God increase my anointing. And this man of God, all he said in his prayers is that, God have mercy. Now, we said last time that when you pray for 4 hours or for 6 hours or for 10 hours, it does not necessarily mean that you go to God with many words. And Jesus said himself that the hypocrites think that God will hear them because of many words. It is not because of many words. You can say thank you to Jesus for 3 hours, yet you are praying for many things. Because prayer is consciousness. Prayer is not, it is what you say must come from your heart. Otherwise, you will be wasting time in the place of prayer. So most of us ask for things instead of thanking God for the things. And I said last time that man was not created to chase things. It is an aberration when man starts to chase for things. When you start to chase for cars, when you start to chase for money, when you start to chase all these things, how God created man, because he said, let us make man in our own image. God does not teach anything on anyone. Meanwhile, when God created man, he said, let him have dominion. What is dominion? Let him be the head of everything. Let him be the compendium that everything will be anchored upon man. And so the moment you start to chase, you operate from the laws that God put. The moment you start to chase, you give the devil a chance now to take over your mind. So you should not chase healing. You should walk in divine healing. You should not, we should not be miracle chasers. This Jehovah chapter is because we do not understand that God has already given us everything that we need. Everything that you go to pray, everything that you tell God, God, I need this, God, I need that, God has already given it, because God is a spirit. That is why when he gave these things, he gave them in the spirit, and he put them in the spirit. Now there are laws and there are ordinances that you need to follow for these things to gain expression. One of the most powerful ways for these things to manifest is through thanksgiving. We were taught here, I think 2 Sundays ago, and we were told, let praise proceed. Let praise proceed. Let praise be the first one to go. Why was that sermon brought to us? It is because the moment complaining proceeds, you've already failed. The moment complaining goes ahead, you've already failed. Because we do not, our war is from the place of victory. Our war is from the place of victory. So that is why the Bible says, let Judah proceed. Let Judah be first. Let praise be first. Let that giving go ahead. So you don't tell God, I need you to heal me. You need to walk in divine healing. You need to tell God, thank you, because 2,000 years ago, I received healing. Thank you, because 2,000 years ago, the Bible says, nothing was made that was made without him. As much as Jesus is in you, all you need, you already have it. The anointing you need, you already have it. The power, you already have it. The mercy, you already have it. So how will it manifest? Because I usually say, it is not helping you when it's in the spirit. Because you are not in the spirit. So it needs to manifest. It needs to manifest. One of the most sure ways to make anything and everything manifest in its time, it's through thanksgiving. One of the most sure ways. We complain a lot. We complain a lot. What God have served you for many years? Why is this happening for me? God have done this. God have done that. You don't know that even before you were born to do those things, God had already provided for you. We don't understand the place from which God sees us from. I remember one day we did a teaching, what is man? And we saw that everything that the devil wanted, now God came and gave it to man. Because the devil said, I will ascend to the mountains. So the devil wanted to run a parallel government. Yet God came and gave all dominion to man. That is why the Bible says, don't you know that ye are gods, and you are the sons of the Most High? But there is a problem. You will die like one of these princes. Why? Because you do not understand. The moment you do not understand that you are a God, that the moment you do not understand what God has invested in you, God has gone through a lot for you to have what you have. Do you know how many people died before Christ was born? When we understand these things, prayer will not be about God give me. Prayer will not be about God I need. Prayer will be about thank you God. God has created everything he had to create. I told you last time, your car is not with God. It is in a yard somewhere. So you need to know how you will get it from that yard to you. The most sure way, pray the prayers of thanksgiving. Let your prayers, if possible, 98%, let it be thanksgiving when it comes to petitions. Because God knows what you need. He knows it. He knows it. And he has already given it to you. So let's learn one or two things. Philippians chapter 4. There are things that are mandatory whenever you engage in the prayer of thanksgiving. Let's start from 4, verse 4. It says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Number one, never lose your joy. Because we say that when it comes to the prayer of thanksgiving, you are thanking God for what he has given you. I know sometimes maybe you are sick, you are in pain, you don't know what to do, and you might be caught up by emotions. And now you are going to God to complain. You will never pray the prayers of thanksgiving if joy does not precede. Let joy be an anchor whenever you want to pray. And this does not only apply to the prayer of thanksgiving. Every time you pray with heartheartedness, the reason is why the Bible says, rejoice in the Lord always, 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 always. So whether things are good or bad, the thing that has not changed, the constant thing is joy. Never ever lose your joy. This is what people do not understand. And that is why we continue to dissipate a lot of energy in the place of prayer, yet little or no results from those prayers. Kwa sababu unaenda kwa Mungu na mazili zako zote, with all your days, baggage, and now you are telling him thank you. Even him, he knows you are not thanking him. Let joy. Joy is a weapon. Joy, that time that you feel like I'm done, like I can even die. Let joy precede. Let joy be the anchor even before you go to pray. Rejoice in the Lord always. King James says, rejoice in the Lord always. As you walk, rejoice in the Lord. Because these things will come. Jesus said in the book of John 16, verse 33, he said, I tell you these things so that in me you might have peace. Sometimes we think the things we are praying for, when we get them, we will get peace or we will have peace. It doesn't happen like that. How many people prayed for jobs for years, and the moment they got that job, that was the beginning of their tears? How many people prayed for families? God, I need a family. The moment they got married, that was the beginning of their tears. How many people prayed for anointing? The moment they got anointing, it is from that anointing that all their tears come from. And he said, I'm telling you these things so that in me you might have peace. Why? Because in the world you shall have tribulations. So we are not bargaining whether there will be tribulation or not. They will be there. What do you, or how do you live with these tribulations? The thing is, rejoice in the Lord always and always. So before you tell him, thank you God for healing me, let it come from the depth of your heart. I don't mean that you should not cry. Cry when it is needed. But sorrow, that is what we see next. The Bible says, don't be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. There is nothing that incapacitates the devil or the enemy when he is expecting you to be sorrowful or to be anxious, yet you are happy. That will make him powerless. That will make him, he will not even have a footstool in your life. Let joy proceed. That is why he said, let praises go, let praises go ahead. You will never praise when you are sorrowful. You will never praise when you are anxious. Don't be anxious about anything. What would happen today if the doctor comes and tells you, you have 2 weeks to live? Most of us will start to complain. God, how can you do this to me? God, I've served you all my life. God this, God that. Don't be anxious about anything. The reason he said anything, it is because he knows many things will come. Many things will come. But the instruction is one. Do not be anxious. Do not be anxious. A story is said of Oyedepo's wife. And she had a foundation and she went to the hospital. And the doctors told her, you only have 2 weeks to live. He's a wife of a known father of faith. But now something has struck. A disease. And she was told, you will not come back from that disease. You only have 2 weeks to live and then you die. She went and gathered over 100 scriptures that talks about healing. And every day she would go through those scriptures and meditate about them. 2 weeks became months. Months became years. Even the doctors could not understand. It is in that anxiety that the devil brings fear. And you will never have fear and survive. You will never. Fear, all demons wait until fear gets into you. That is when they destroy you. They will destroy you to nothingness. Don't be anxious. Never be anxious. Train your spirit that you will not be anxious. Train your mind that no matter what is happening, I have to gauge my eyes. In the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 1, he says, I will stand upon the watch. I will stand upon the watch because I want to see what the Lord will say. How come someone can see what God? God is saying, anxiety must be out of your life. Fear must be out of your life. Many people die the moment fear gets in. So you were living comfortably, but when you were told you have cancer, fear comes in. 3 months later, you are dead. And one of the ways that you keep fear is by prayer of thanksgiving. Sometimes you will not even say anything because you are in pain. You will only kneel down and cry before God and groan. God can read your spirit. He can read your mind. He can read your heart. Make up your mind today that you will not be anxious. Make up your mind today. Sometimes you'll be needing house rent. It's already 10. And fear gets in. It is fear that shows people that you can steal. It is fear that shows people that you can do this and this. It's fear that shows people you can compromise for the sake of the situation at hand. But God is not caught by surprise. Your situation did not catch him by surprise. What you need to know, engage in the prayer of thanksgiving. Engage. Make sure that you thanksgiving invokes the dimension of God that you are thanking him for. If you tell God, thank you, Father, because you healed me, and you say it from a clear conscience, and you say it from a point of understanding, let me tell you, no matter what happens, you will be healed. Because he healed us 2,000 years ago. He says by his stripes, we were healed. Not we will be healed. We were healed. The problem with believers is that we want to put present tense or future tense to things that God has already done. When he said you were healed, is it too hard to believe that? And one of the ways to raise your faith, it is to engage in the prayers of thanksgiving. So let joy be part of your prayer. Let joy proceed. Let joy go ahead. Let joy go ahead. And every time you are caught up in a situation, you don't know what to do, the greatest thing you can do and the most important thing you can do, it is to thank God. Thank him day and night. Thank him. Thank him. And it will not be long. Once now you are minded, your spirit and your soul and one, you will find that the things that you worry about are not as difficult as they look. Many people have been looking for jobs for years, but when they go to pray, they complain to God. God, my mother has been a pastor for 10 years. How comes I cannot get a job? Is this how you reward your people? Don't go to God with such kind of attitude, because you will not get anything. When praise goes ahead, when thanksgiving goes ahead, when you are filled with joy, you realize that even God will start to realign your mindset. There is a year I prayed for a car. I prayed. But when I started to thank God, I came to realize that the car was not an emergency. God started to show me other things that are more important to me than that car. So the things that you think are urgent to you, they are not urgent in the spirit. There are more urgent things in the spirit. I said last time that the thing you are running after, what you are pursuing, is also pursuing you. Because that is how the world was created. The world was created that everything and anything must be subject to man. It must be subject to man. But that thing is not looking for the version of you. So you need to work on yourself. How do you work on yourself? The moment you go to God to pray and you start to thank Him, He will start to reveal to you, I know you wanted this, but this is what you need now. And even that lust, even that desire, you find that with time it will die. And you start to focus on more important thing of the kingdom. Praise the name of the Lord.
Yes, you are the Lord. Hosanna. Yes, you are the Lord. Hosanna. Yes, you are the Lord.
Father, we thank you and we worship you. Thank you for the moment of you've given us to hear your word. We praise you, for there is none like you. And as you continue to teach us, let our spirits be open, let our mind be open to learn. Because you say the things that are written before us were written for our learning. Do you say that when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He shall guide you into all truth? What we pray is that the truth of your word shall come alive in our spirits, and we shall walk in your ways, and we shall walk in your ordinances, and we shall not sleep out of the way. We worship you and we glorify you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray and we believe.